Once upon a time, the earth was flat, or so most men believed. Mariners who sailed the seas stayed close to land, dreading the legendary horrors that lay in wait below the edge of the world. There were men who believed the earth was round, but few were brave enough to try to prove it. In 1492, Columbus started round the world to India, but instead discovered America. 20 years later, Ferdinand Magellan set sail with 5 small ships. But after 3 years, only one returned. 4 ships and Magellan's own life were the price of the first completed voyage round the world. For centuries, travel was slow and uncertain. But in 1840, a new era began. The first Cunard liner, the Britannia, became the first ship in history to carry transatlantic passengers on regular schedule. In the century that has followed, progress in ships and navigation has been tremendous. The great Cunard fleet, headed today by the world's largest superliners, the Queen Mary and the Queen Elizabeth, has carried millions of passengers across the sea in speed and luxury. Another liner whose funnel wears the familiar colors of Cunard is the famous Caronia. The Caronia is the largest ocean liner ever built, especially for round-the-world cruising. But big as she is, over 34,000 tons, more than 700 feet long, the Caronia has the lines and beauty of a yacht. Her unique green color, which softens the glare of tropic sunlight, has inspired the people of the Orient to christen her the Green Goddess. Here, on a bright, freezing January day, this most famous of all cruise ships is leaving New York for a modern, round-the-world adventure. So why not come aboard? This is John Bransby speaking, inviting you to travel with us in this majestic floating resort from January until May. Our journey will take us to Trinidad and Brazil, across the South Atlantic to Tristan da Cunha and to South Africa, over the warm Indian Ocean to Zanzibar and the Seychelles, to India and Ceylon. We'll go to Singapore, to Thailand and romantic Bali. We'll sail to Manila and Hong Kong and visit Japan in cherry blossom time. We'll enjoy Hawaii, California, Mexico and Panama. 23 ports in 17 countries. Out in the open sea, the great ship becomes a world apart, a smooth-sailing, air-conditioned world. As you get acquainted with 15 spacious public rooms, stroll along 800 feet of glass-enclosed promenade, discover acres of terraced open-deck space for play and relaxation, you'll find that cruising on the Caronia adds a new dimension to traveling and living. On one of your first evenings at sea, the captain's reception will be your introduction to the gaiety of Caronia cruise life. Here you'll meet the ship's master, his staff, and many congenial traveling companions. When the reception and the party are over, you'll feel completely at home in your new surroundings. Every morning, after a night of refreshing sleep, you open your eyes eager for another day of this new kind of living. Breakfasting at your leisure, in your stateroom or in one of the restaurants, is just part of the seagoing way of life born with that first Cunarder more than 100 years ago. As time goes on, you'll get acquainted with many parts of the ship, and you'll find elevators serving every deck. This big floating resort has all the facilities, services, and conveniences of any city, anywhere in the world. For example, there's the purser's office, where they distribute the mail, cash travelers' checks, keep your passport, and handle all the details that make your cruise completely carefree. There's a circulating library, and in this quiet writing room, you can share your adventures by letter with family and friends at home. There's a gymnasium equipped for all kinds of exercise. Nearby are Turkish baths and massage, and of course there's a doctor, a surgeon, a dentist, and a complete physiotherapy department. There are convenient shops where you can buy everyday needs. You'll find cashmere sweaters and famous British goods at tax-free prices. Fine English china and cutlery, French perfumes, dress accessories, and all sorts of souvenirs. If you have questions about shopping or any other cruise activity, just drop by during hostess hour in one of the garden lounges. Winter weather is now just a fading memory. You can relax in a deck chair, read the books you haven't had time for, or just sit around and do nothing at all while you enjoy the sunshine and the fresh sea air. Good company and interesting conversation you'll always find in the air-conditioned observation lounge. Your cruise companions come from all parts of the United States and Canada, from South America and Europe. And Caronia service is wherever you happen to be. Now and then, you like to have a more intimate party in your own stateroom or suite. No need to worry about what to serve or how to serve it. Wherever you give a party in the ship, every detail will be perfect, for the Caronia's wine cellars are stocked with a connoisseur's selection, her larders with a gourmet's choice of delicacies from round the world. As lunchtime draws near, the salad chefs are busy getting ready for the buffet lunch to be served on deck. The informal al fresco deck buffet features a wide choice of dishes, and the menu in the air-conditioned restaurants is even larger and more varied. The Caronia's wonderful cuisine means that the many different kitchens are always beehives of activity. Bakery and pastry shops are busy day and night, turning out plain and fancy breads and rolls, mouth-watering assortments of pies and cakes, and pastries of so many kinds it would be hard even to sample them all. The hors d'oeuvre chefs create endless varieties of taste-inspiring canapés. The quantities seem astronomic, but you'll see these appetizers disappear like magic when, before dinner, you find your way to the smoking room, the veranda cafe, or this intimate forward cocktail bar. Cocktail hour is another of the pleasant everyday customs at sea. A refreshing interlude of genial companionship before you sit down to dinner. The Caronia's distinguished twin restaurants, the Sandringham and the Balmoral, offer an international cuisine served in a festive and leisure mood. There's fresh fish from every sea through which we sail. There are game birds and fowl of many sorts. There are the world's finest roasts of beef from the best herds of Scotland and America. Or perhaps you'd prefer to have your meat broiled to order on the charcoal grill. Prime chops, fillets, or steaks done exactly as you like them, all enhanced by the bouquet of vintage wines. Your dessert may be crepe Suzette or cherries Jubilee, maybe a cake to celebrate a special day. There's no limit but your imagination, for the pastry chefs are busy with their magic till the last dessert is served. Yes, this is pleasant living in a happy ship. But happy days fly swiftly, so let's see where we are. Only a few days from the wintry north, we've sailed across the warm Gulf Stream, paused for a day in tropic Trinidad, and now not far ahead lies the equator. As the ship crosses that invisible line, King Neptune himself rises from the sea to welcome all the members of the great world crew. While everyone enjoys the fun and cameras are clicking, our captain becomes the first initiate into the ancient order of the deep. Later, King Neptune and his court are received in the great main lounge. Passengers receive royal diplomas with appropriate ceremony. His Majesty Neptunus Rex promises smooth sailing, 34,000 happy miles for Caronia round the world travelers. Beyond the equator, the Caronia calls next at ancient Bahia, colonial capital of Brazil for 200 years. In the lower town and the upper town, which are joined by a huge elevator, one may wander through historic old streets and buildings and the quiet patios of colonial churches and monasteries. There's plenty of time to drive along the scenic shoreline of Brazil and to shop for souvenirs of our visit, including these colorful Bahian dolls. When we rejoin our floating home to leave Bahia, we head south again to Brazil's present-day capital, Rio de Janeiro. Entering Rio Harbor, we steam past famous Sugar Loaf. For 2 days, we'll live in our luxurious floating hotel right near the center of the city. A stone's throw from the showrooms of famous Brazilian jewel merchants, the fine stores and towering skyscrapers of downtown Rio, and the gay hotels, shops, and restaurants of world-renowned Copacabana Beach. You'll soon find that sightseeing in Rio is often vertical rather than horizontal. With moving views of the city and harbor spread out below, safe aerial tramways carry you right to the peak of Sugar Loaf. Up here, you think you're on top of the world, till you look up again and see the peak of Corcovado towering high against the sky. By auto or tram car from the city, you can ride almost to the top. Then, a few more steps, and you stand at the base of the huge statue of Christ the Redeemer, which gazes eternally down on this incomparable panorama. The magnificent vista from this towering height is one you never forget. And when we leave this beautiful harbor, the colossal statue of Christ dominates the skyline until our last sunset glimpse of Rio is lost to view behind Sugar Loaf. In her voyage across the South Atlantic to Cape Town, the Caronia makes one of the most unusual stops on any cruise, the tiny far-off island of Tristan da Cunha. When Napoleon was in exile on St. Helena to the north, a British garrison was placed here to keep the French from using this rugged volcanic island as a rescue base. Our camera enthusiasts are looking for human interest shots, and here they are. Almost the entire population of about 300 people rowing out in their island-built canvas-covered boats. These are English-speaking descendants of the original British soldiers who remained in this lonely habitation. The approach to Tristan is too rugged for us to go ashore, but if weather permits, the people of the island are invited aboard the ship. It's the biggest day of the year for them, and a memorable experience for us. It's fun to buy their souvenirs of the island, and it's a field day for stamp collectors. After saying goodbye to the friendly folk of Tristan da Cunha, it's time to plan for the Caronia's beautiful red and white ball to celebrate St. Valentine's Day. St. Valentine's is but one of the Caronia's gaily decorated and costumed balls. There are South American Night, Washington's Birthday, St. Patrick's Day, and many more. There are dancing classes and private instruction. All these dances and other social affairs throughout the Great World Cruise are planned by the cruise director and his staff. programs, concerts, movies, tournaments, all kinds of special events that add fun and variety to every day at sea. For example, the fancy headdress parade is a fabulous fantasy of millinery monkey shine. Prizes are awarded for originality, artistry, authenticity, and humor. Materials come from everywhere, including the salad kitchen. Each contestant creates his or her own chapeau, and it's a lot of fun for everyone, whether young or old. As we draw near to the great continent of Africa, the Big Shore Excursion Office on the main deck hums with activity. Many cruise members have arranged for shore excursions or extended inland tours, and all details are put in order before we dock. At the bank desk, you can buy traveler's checks or exchange your dollars for foreign currency. On the day before our arrival at each new port, the cruise lecturer provides a colorful preview of what we'll see ashore. In South Africa, a dozen shore excursions and optional tours cover all this fascinating land of gold and diamonds, of big game and wonders of nature, of modern cities and primitive tribes. You can spend a week or more ashore, then meet the ship again at Durban, or even take a long safari through the heart of equatorial Africa, rejoining the cruise at Zanzibar. All these journeys begin at Cape Town, which lies spread out below the mighty escarpment of Table Mountain. By swift aerial railway, it takes only a few minutes to climb the 4,000 foot heights. From the top, you look down on a magnificent panorama of the mother city of South Africa, a haven for mariners since days of the earliest explorers. Down in the city, modern buildings such as the Museum of Art in its botanical garden setting contrast with the old Dutch castle built almost three centuries ago. Picturesque suburbs are framed in the natural splendor of giant cliffs and shimmering sea. In Africa are some of nature's most majestic creations. Approaching Victoria Falls by air, you see at a glance how the great Zambezi River drops 420 feet into a rocky chasm. This colossal cataract is twice as wide and more than twice as high as Niagara. From the edges of the river gorge, you can safely view and photograph all the tumultuous beauty of the world's greatest waterfall. A modern man-made wonder of South Africa is the Golden City, Johannesburg, built on the site of one of the richest gold discoveries in history. Outside the city, gigantic mine dumps stretch as far as you can see. If you're here on a Sunday morning, you may see an unforgettable spectacle. Each week, the different African tribesmen who work in the mines put on their famous mine dances. Pretoria, administrative capital of South Africa, is called the Garden City. The Union Building, home of the government, looks down over gorgeous terraced flower gardens descending from level to level below. It's hard to leave all this beauty and brilliant color behind, even to go looking for big game. Fine highways lead to Kruger Park, world's largest game reserve, almost as big as the state of Connecticut. Within the park, you spend the night in comfortable round houses called rondavels. Meals are served within the confines of convenient rest camps, for here, humans are caged while animals roam free. From 7:15 at night till 5 in the morning, visitors must be in and the gates are locked. But at the crack of dawn, we're on the road. And as long as we stay in our cars, we're safe. The sun's first rays may reveal a herd of wildebeest or some of the thousands of impala. This graceful antelope is the lion's favorite food. The baboon is a friend, for he often warns when a lion is near. Like all the monkey race, baboons are as curious about us as we are about them. The smaller monkeys are more nervous, but just give them time, and soon they too are posing for pictures. All these wild animals you may shoot, with a camera, of course, right from your car. There's the ugly and ferocious warthog, the black and white striped zebra, and the skyscraper giraffe, who often feeds from treetops right along the roads. Here's the only spot you're allowed to get out of your car. The hippo pool, where these slow-moving monsters are easy to photograph if you have a long-range lens. There's the dangerous black rhino, and the milder-tempered white rhino, which you'll find at Shushlui. African elephants, plentiful in northern Kruger Park, sometimes wander down here to the south. But your big moment is when a great tawny lioness almost touches your car. Or you have to share the road with the king of beasts himself. The tribesmen of Africa make exciting pictures too. They love to dress up and go into a dance. It's easy to see where rhythm was born. The Zulus were once a fierce warrior tribe, and war dances reenact their legendary prowess with the weapons of battle. The Zulus' love of dress reaches its height in the costumes of the rickshaw men of Durban, who compete for an annual prize awarded to the most elaborate and colorful. Here at Durban, fast-growing resort metropolis on the Indian Ocean, our South African adventure ends. Our own luxurious round-the-world travel resort is already waiting to welcome us home. And how we revel in being home again. Air conditioning feels mighty good. So does a visit to one of the ship's beauty salons. You made your date before you left Cape Town. And now, after your trip through Africa, your favorite hairdresser is waiting for you at the appointed hour. As for the gentleman, there's nothing like a welcome home visit to the ship's fine barbershop. Modern dry cleaning and pressing is hard to find in many lands, but your valet service is perfection at the touch of a button. And the Caronia's laundry, one of the finest afloat, can wash and iron 400,000 pieces on a single cruise. It's good to have your own telephone again, too. You can call your family or business associates back home, or invite your friends in the ship to join you for cocktails. Perhaps here at the Raleigh Room Bar. You dress as you please, and everybody enjoys the informal house party atmosphere of being home again at sea. And now we're going to see more islands rarely visited by ships on cruise. Zanzibar off the African coast and the Seychelles Islands in the Indian Ocean. As we drop anchor at Zanzibar, the soft land breeze wafts the fragrance of spice. From Zanzibar comes almost all of the world's supply of cloves. And here we can see them grow. The clove, familiar to every cook, is the flower bud of the clove tree. Before the blossoms open, these tiny buds are picked and dried and shipped away around the world. The streets and bazaars are crowded. Driving through the narrow streets, we're reminded that Zanzibar was once the notorious world center of the slave trade. In the Seychelles Islands, you'll see plenty of strange specimens, zoological as well as botanical. Tortoiseshell is used for many articles of commerce, but these in the botanical garden are safe as long as they entertain the visitors. A botanical rarity is the huge double coconut, the coco de mer, found nowhere but in the Seychelles. The nuts are sawed and polished into decorative and useful souvenirs of the islands. In Port Victoria, everyone has plenty of time to shop in the busy marketplace. As the Caronia leaves the Seychelles, we head eastward again toward India, land of ancient civilization and fabulous riches. At Bombay, we enter the harbor to be welcomed by the Gateway of India. Behind it, the famous Taj Mahal Hotel. Big, bustling Bombay is India's second largest city, a modern railroad, highway, and air transport center. After spending a day or two in this beautiful seaside metropolis, most of us will be off on our choice of visits to a dozen of the ancient cities of India, Pakistan, and Nepal. Those who want to see all of India may travel for 10 days, 2 weeks, or more, joining the ship again at Colombo in Ceylon or at a later port. Most optional tours include Delhi, capital of the new Indian Republic. The Secretariat and other modern government buildings in New Delhi form a striking contrast to the world-famed structures of Old Delhi. Among these are the towering Qutub Minar and the Old Stone Observatory, once used by Indian astronomers to study the heavens. A hallowed shrine is this simple platform where Mahatma Gandhi was cremated. But of all the holy places of Hinduism, there is none like Banaras on the banks of the Ganges River. Here, hordes of devout Hindus gather to worship. Sacred cattle roam unmolested among the throng, and sacred monkeys are fed and cared for in memory of the monkey god. Here, temple overshadows temple, but the river itself, the sacred Ganges, is the goal of every pilgrimage. As our sightseeing boats drift slowly along the river bank, we get intimate glimpses of thousands of Hindus as they bathe in the purifying waters, cleansing both their bodies and their souls, according to their belief. Holy men and their disciples spend endless days in prayer and meditation, practicing their devotions completely oblivious of us or our cameras. Wherever you go in India, you find the color and hubbub of crowded bazaars, the homes of craftsmen whose intricate arts have been handed down since time immemorial. You see on one hand the teeming life of present-day India's 400 million population. On the other hand, countless monuments to the wealth and glory of vanished empires. Not far from Agra is Fatehpur Sikri, the deserted city built by the great Mughal Emperor Akbar. With its courtyards and mosques, the magnificent decorations of red sandstone, and the graceful perfection of the Prophet's white marble tomb. In the city of Agra is the mighty Mughal fort, with its massive battlements and ornate towers atop the walls. It was in this golden jasmine tower that the deposed emperor, Shah Jahan, was imprisoned within sight of his own masterpiece, the Taj Mahal. Your own first glimpse of this architectural wonder of the world may be as the first faint shafts of sunrise touch the dome and minarets, or as the soft light of early morning spreads across the sky. Hour by hour, the vision changes from rosy dawn and drifting river mist to the blinding brilliance of the Taj at noon. The Taj Mahal is so delicate in its form, so perfect in its symmetry, that a realization of its enormous size may completely escape you until you compare it with human beings walking like tiny ants around the base. Built to the memory of Mumtaz Mahal, beloved wife of Shah Jahan, the building took 20,000 artisans more than 20 years to complete. The walls are white marble, carved in delicate bas-relief and inlaid with flower-like designs of agate, bloodstone, jasper, and many other semi-precious stones. The white marble seems to turn to gold as the sun sinks toward the west. But the unforgettable climax comes after the sun has set, and only the soft light of the moon illuminates the scene. Moonlight on the Taj Mahal. The same magic moon glow that ripples on the harbor at Bombay as our visit to India comes to an end. Two days later, in Colombo, capital of Ceylon, we find ourselves in one of the busiest ports of the East. Colombo is one of the important jewel markets of the world, for Ceylon is famous for precious gems. This lush tropic island is also famous for its tea. Driving up scenic mountain highways, you'll visit tea plantations from which come much of the world's supply. You'll discover many varieties of tropical trees and plants, including the towering royal palm. And you'll share the highway with some unusual traffic companions. The elephant is Ceylon's animal of all work. Truck, tractor, and mobile power plant all in one. But like the rest of us who spend a busy day, Jumbo gets an occasional break. A break he relishes to the full. High in the hills is the great Buddhist shrine of Kandy, where you'll see the Temple of the Tooth and have a chance to take pictures of the famous Kandyan dancers, whose storytelling steps and gestures are accompanied by long, double-ended drums, music which sounds very strange indeed to Occidental ears. As the dance ritual proceeds, the gyrations get wilder. And I'm sure no one from the Caronia tried to learn this particular dance. But the ladies learned plenty about the dresses of India and Ceylon. Back again on the Caronia, they give a style show in saris, those beautiful oriental garments draped from yards of exquisite hand-woven cotton or silk. After the active days on land, it's wonderful to slow down again to the unhurried, do-as-you-please tempo of shipboard life. Here in the smoking room or in the veranda cafe, there's instruction in contract bridge almost every day at sea, and there are popular prize tournaments in bridge, canasta, and Bolivia. Every day in the theater, there's a new movie, the latest hits from Hollywood and Europe. Judging by our candid camera shots, this one certainly can't be a tragedy. In the main lounge, there's always music for tea time by the Caronia Light Orchestra. Of course, afternoon tea is an old British tradition. You can have it served at your chair anywhere on deck, in your stateroom, or in public rooms, including the big main lounge, where you have the pleasant music of the orchestra to entertain you. Continuing our journey eastward, the Caronia's next port of call is the island city of Singapore, at the tip of Malaya. In Singapore, crossroads of the East, the big buildings and fine hotels of this important British Crown colony form a stretch of oriental streets and the crowded riverfront where many of the city's million inhabitants live. Here in Singapore, we're entering one of the most colorful parts of our round-the-world cruise, including the city of Bangkok in Thailand, which in our school days was called Siam. In Bangkok, we're transported into a storybook land of bygone ages. In the Imperial Palace and in fantastic temples like the great Wat Pho, we wander in the midst of Oriental splendor almost beyond description. There's the Marble Temple with its strange stone lions and its row of bronze Buddhas in all the traditional postures of prayer and meditation. Across the river is the Temple of the Dawn, where only color film can catch the brilliance of the buildings, the images, and the saffron-robed Buddhist priests themselves. The countless figures that seem to hold up the temple towers are covered with elaborate ceramic mosaics. It looks as though the ancient Siamese had smashed up all their dishes to decorate the walls and statues. The river leads us into the intimate life of the canals, or khlongs, where many of the people of Bangkok live. The khlongs are like streets, lined with homes and businesses, and crowded with waterborne traffic. Floating markets sell everything, from farm produce to hardware, fish and meat to textiles and clothes. As we sail by, we get intimate glimpses of everyday family life. Further from the city, the khlongs are like green country lanes, peaceful and quiet. As evening falls and temples are silhouetted against the sky, we start down the river again, homeward bound to the Caronia. With us, we take a lot of Thailand. Not only pictures and memories, but silks and satins, costumes and jewelry, some of which will be seen tonight in the fancy dress parade. In the Caronia, you'll see costumes from many of the countries we've visited, as well as all kinds of original ones made in the ship. The judges have a hard job choosing the winners out of 100 or more in the parade. There are prizes for the most artistic, the most original, the best group costumes, and the most humorous. These clear, warm days in the tropics bring most everybody out into the sunshine. An early continental breakfast on the Lido deck fits right in with the easygoing informality that everyone enjoys. Forward of the funnel, on the sheltered sports deck, the ladies' Keep Fit class takes full advantage of the sunshine and fresh salt air. Those who like to play games for exercise have plenty of choice. Of course, shuffleboard's a favorite. There are prize tournaments for ladies, gentlemen, and mixed doubles. Deck tennis is another traditional shipboard sport. This game takes a bit of speed and energy, but neither speed nor energy is needed for the favorite deck sport of all, sunbathing. The prize in this game is a healthy tan that winterbound friends at home would surely envy. If the sunshine is too soothing, a plunge in the pool does wonders toward waking you up. No matter how we spend our leisure hours, these days at sea pass all too quickly. It's even hard to find time to show your pictures and color slides, which have been developed and returned to you aboard the ship. A priceless personal record of your trip. Some travelers collect foreign music recordings for their record libraries. Some even make tape recordings of their own. This strange, exotic music from Bali will always bring back a vivid memory of that far-off Indonesian island. The thrill of having one of your fondest travel dreams come true. To think of Bali is to remember another world. A world of ancient temples in an island almost untouched by the hand of time. An island of simple living and charm seldom found in our fast-moving world of today. Here the rice paddies climb the steepest hills and spread an emerald carpet in the valley. Yes, memory will crowd upon memory. The square in Padang Bay, where we shop for batiks and native prints. For weird ceremonial masks. Or the carved wooden heads for which Bali is so famous. And of course, the music reminds us of the dancers themselves. These are the Jangar dancers, one of many groups, each of which has its own different dances, costumes, and music. Another memory to take home with us as the green goddess carries us away again across the sea. Cruising northward again, our next port of call is Manila, capital of the Philippines. We sail into Manila Bay, past the gaunt fortress of Corregidor, with its tragic memories of war and suffering. But we're greeted with all the color and warmth of this ancient city of Spanish heritage. Although Manila was almost wholly destroyed by the Second World War, our day's visit shows us a fast-developing new capital, symbolizing the indomitable spirit of the people of the Philippines. Sailing from Manila to Hong Kong across the China Sea, we reach one of the great strategic outposts of the Orient. Said Rudyard Kipling, "East is east, and west is west, and never the twain shall meet." But here they do. The great Occidental commercial, financial, and shopping centers of the city of Victoria rub shoulders with all the Oriental color and mystery of the Chinese. In the countless shops of Victoria and Kowloon, at Freeport prices, you can go on a shopping spree for the bargains of a lifetime. Your Hong Kong sightseeing will take you to the fishing village of Aberdeen, Scotch in name only, and crowded with strange Oriental craft. Our sampan water taxi is rowed by a mother and her daughter, each with a tiny baby on her back. This is the surging life of the Orient, where countless people are born, live, and die on the tiny sampans that scurry round the harbors and the great Chinese junks that sail out to the open sea. And now, climax of our Oriental visit, Japan, where our leisurely itinerary provides a full week in this island empire. The rising sun, symbol of Japan, silhouettes the Caronia as we arrive at our pier to be greeted by a group of beautiful dancing geishas. These are the traditional hostesses of Japan, trained from infancy in all the feminine charms and graces. The schedule of our trip coincides with the time of snow-white cherry blossoms and rose-pink plum blossoms, when city and village streets are gay with color. In the morning, from the window of our train, we can see snow-capped Fujiyama look down upon the fresh spring countryside. In the evening, across Lake Hakone, we see Mount Fuji again, this time in dim, misty outline that reminds us of a classic Japanese print. The characteristic red gates, the torii, add color to the Oriental landscape, and blossom-laden trees frame the ancient shrines and temples. The Golden Pavilion of Kyoto was built almost 100 years before Columbus discovered America. Among almost endless attractions is the famous park in Nara, where tame deer roam at will among the crowds of visitors. The Japanese learn early in life to love the age-old beauties and traditions of their land. In springtime, every shrine is crowded with visitors. Thousands of Japanese flock to the great Daibutsu, the giant bronze Buddha of Kamakura, which has been worshipped here under the sun and moon for 700 years. As we leave Cherry Blossom Land, the people of Yokohama express their thanks for our visit with a Western-style brass band to play us off. But for our part, we've almost forgotten our Western ways. Oriental night in the Caronia is a brilliant carnival, a kaleidoscope of color from every Oriental land that we have visited. Through the red torii in the prom deck square go storybook characters from everywhere, even the Mikado himself with his charming empress. Geisha girls are kept busy bringing trays of sake from the sake house of the April moon. Seldom, if ever, in your travels anywhere, will you find yourself in such happy company, in so happy a ship. Everybody, young and old, enjoys the fun of make-believe. Yes, from every land in the Orient, we've brought with us the color and the beauty. And not until the last gong has sounded do we really say goodbye to the Orient and aloha, Hawaii. This is Honolulu, American paradise of the Pacific. Swaying hulas, Diamond Head, the beach at Waikiki. Surf riding and boating, all the attractions for which Hawaii is renowned. 2 days in this lotus land of pleasure, and then the Caronia calls us home once more. It's aloha oi, traditional farewell to Hawaii. Before Before we pass Diamond Head, throw your leis into the sea and you'll be sure to return. California, here we come. This is a chance to get a vivid glimpse of our own West Coast. San Francisco, or Long Beach, Los Angeles, and Hollywood, depending on the Caronia's route for the year. From California, one may visit Mexico, Central America, and Panama, while the ship sails south to Acapulco, sun-drenched Riviera of southern Mexico. The harbor which once sheltered the treasure-filled Spanish galleons from Manila is today one of the favorite playgrounds of the Western Hemisphere. Big new hotels cluster round the bay. Your snapshots will include fine scenic views and the diving boys in their spectacular leaps from the cliffs. From Acapulco south, we'll have topside weather. Balmy tropic days ideal for outdoor parties on deck. For now, time is fleeting, and we cherish every minute that we can spend with our round-the-world friends. An evening in Panama City will be our farewell to gay nightlife ashore. Then, early morning will find us in the great locks of Pedro Miguel on our way through the Panama Canal. Those who've been through the canal before may want to see more of Panama and cross the isthmus by car or train. But everyone wants to experience at least once the transit of this 49-mile shortcut, which saves thousands of miles between the Atlantic and the Pacific Oceans. As the pilot boat drops astern at Cristobal, and we begin to pick up speed, our golden hours are running low indeed. But as we look back, we know in our hearts that this journey will never end. For in years to come, every mention of world travel will bring back a flood of memories of our trip. From the tropic beaches of Trinidad to the shores of Bali, from the mighty escarpments of Africa to the rugged coastline of Mexico, we'll remember cities, shrines, and monuments, Cape Town, and faraway Bangkok, the monuments of India, the shrines of Japan, the ruins of old Panama. We'll remember fascinating people, the Zulus of South Africa, the Arabs of Zanzibar, the Hindus of Benares, the produce vendors at Kandy, the wood carvers of Bali, the hula dancers of Hawaii, and the fishermen of Acapulco. 1,000 memories from everywhere, from rhinos and rainbows to sunset on the Taj Mahal and sunrise on the sea. But most of all, we'll remember what fun it was and how easy, with our own luxury hotel always at our service in strange and far-off ports. Each time we stepped aboard, we knew our safety and comfort was in the hands of a century of experience in seamanship and service.
Yes, sir, what can I do for you?
Service that extended to every corner of the big ship, every deck, every lounge and public room. And who could forget dining in our home away from home? The perfect service, famous international cuisine, and the gay atmosphere of the ship's restaurants. It's going to be hard to say goodbye to carefree days on sunny decks, the lazy hours of play, the informality of shipboard life, and all the happy cruising friends who filled our days with fun. We're going to miss the sight of the sea curving from the prow of the Caronia, our friendly floating home for more than 100 days. But as the Statue of Liberty welcomes our return to the skyline of New York, we know a new homecoming thrill that must have been felt by explorers of old. For now, we too have been around the world.